morning. I'm Michaela van der Schaar, and I'm the director of the Cambridge Center for AI in Medicine. Today, I would like to tell you about our work, where we use machine learning on the basis of Public Health England data, and we've developed a technology which we hope can inform hospitals on how to cope with COVID-19. Our team includes various members of the Cambridge Center for AI in Medicine, inclusively members of my own research lab, Machine Learning and Artificial Intelligence for Medicine, Dr. Ahmed Allah and Zhao Zhijian. We also have other members of the Cambridge Center for AI in Medicine, Dr. Ari Ercole, who is an intensive care unit doctor, Professor Stefan Scholtes, Professor Daniela De Angelis, as well as our colleagues and collaborators from Public Health England, NHS Improvement and NHS England, Dr. Anis Pari and Dr. Jenadin Linehan. The focus of this work is to develop technology to protect the NHS. The real challenge posed by COVID-19 is managing the limited available healthcare resources. And this is true not only in the United Kingdom, but it is true more generally at the global level. We have heard a lot in the last couple of weeks about flattening the curve, flattening the demand for healthcare resources. And a lot has been talked about this at the national level. However, we believe that this is also a very important point at the local level. So even with a nationally flat curve, specific hospitals in specific regions may still surpass capacity. So it is the focus of this technology that we are developing to help healthcare professionals manage hospital level resources. So our goal is to provide evidence that can reliably assist the difficult decisions that clinicians and managers have to make to, in order to be able to save lives. So I would like to emphasize here that the focus of our work is not to replace such clinicians and managers and allow machine learning to make decisions. This is not our focus. What we would like to do is to use the available data to provide evidence that can inform these decisions. So what we are doing is we are using anonymized Public Health England data as well as technologies in machine learning that we have developed in our lab over the years and have been validated in a variety of settings to forecast personalized risk for each patient, personalized patient benefit from using particular types of resources, identifying which treatments and resources are needed by which patient and when, as well as forecast future resource requirements at the hospital level based on current demand. What decisions do healthcare professionals need to make? Upon admission to the hospital, COVID patients may do well after some time and may be able to safely go home. We would like to identify when the patient can be discharged and what's the probability to be discharged within a certain amount of time. We also would like to identify which patients will need to go to the intensive care units, ICUs, and when. Upon admission to the ICU, we would like to identify which patients should be on ventilators, possibly what type of ventilators, and for how long they will need to be on these ventilators. We also would like to predict when the patients will be discharged. We would like to make all such predictions with confidence estimates associated with them. It is important to do this because we have limits on resources, ICU beds, ventilators, and even healthcare personnel. So in order to achieve the best possible utilization of available resources, we would like to make such predictions about what resources are needed and when, as well as identify the personalized benefit from these resources at the current time. For this, we are using Public Health England CHESS data, and CHESS stands for COVID-19 Hospitalization in England Surveillance System. We used the CHESS data collected until March 29, 2020, and this contains a variety of variables, I'd like to emphasize that this is anonymized data. By March 29, 2020, we had 1,694 COVID patients recorded in the CHESS dataset. And this data is continuously updated. The data contains personalized information, but anonymized information, as I'm going to show to you next. Laboratory details, meaning information whether the patient is indeed diagnosed with COVID-19, hospitalization details, risk factors, and outcomes. The demographic information we have is the age of the patient, and you can see that patients that are older are generally admitted, the gender of the patients, and you can see here that the males are more often admitted than the females, the place they are admitted from, and you can see here that most patients until this date were mainly admitted directly from home rather than being transferred from other hospitals. The statistics in terms of resource utilization are as follows. So you see that out of the 694 patients, 9% of them were dead, 9% of them were discharged, and a majority of them were still hospitalized. You can also see the number of patients on ventilators. And what you can see in the graph here on the left-hand side of the slide is that most of the patients were almost immediately admitted to the ICU upon hospitalization. Who is being admitted to the ICU? You can see the statistics of the admission in this slide. You can see it both in terms of age, gender, but also onset to diagnosis. So how long was there till from the time the patients exhibited symptoms to the moment they were diagnosed with COVID-19, as well as how the different comorbidities may have played a role. Who is being ventilated? The same type of statistics you can find on this particular slide. So what have we done on the basis of this data? We have developed an evidence support system that we call Ajutorium. And Ajutorium uses a variety of technologies that we have developed in our lab. The main method is autoprognosis, which is a state-of-the-art automated machine learning framework that we have developed and validated on many data sets in the past. And this is used to issue forecasts. In addition, we are using another technology developed in our lab, Survival Quills, which does state-of-the-art automated machine learning for time-to-event analysis. These technologies automatically craft machine learning ensembles, so they use a large number of machine learning methods whose parameters are automatically optimized and who are joined in ensembles that are issuing predictions. We are issuing predictions of various events, whether somebody will die within a certain time window, will be discharged from the hospital, or will be admitted to the ICU. And we are modeling this also in a time-to-event fashion, and we are able to say how the probability of, for instance, being admitted to the ICU may be changing and may evolving over time. The model is updated as more data is added to the CHESS data. So we are forecasting in real time as more data is collecting using our Ajutorium tool, personalized risk for each patient, for instance, personalized risk of death within a certain time window, as well as what is the personalized benefit from these resources. For instance, the personalized benefit from being admitted to the ICU or being put on a ventilator and when. We are able in this case to also forecast which treatments are needed by each patient and when, and on the basis of this, identify what are the future resource requirements that are needed by a local hospital on the basis of the currently admitted patients. How well are our methods doing? Quite well. As a matter of fact, the area under receiver operating curve for predicting mortality is very high, as you can see in here. And this is for the case that all the features are considered. But even if we use age, specific comorbidities, and time from symptoms to hospitalization, the performance remains very high. If we just enter the age and the number of comorbidities, the performance decreases quite a lot. And if we only consider age, which was considered in some countries, the performance is even lower. Also, we would like to highlight that this method is doing a lot better than linear models such as Cox regression or the Charleston index. What is the value of information? What is the value that one particular variable adds to our prediction performance is highlighted here. And I would like to ask you to take this with a grain of salt because we only have limited data, but it is interesting to see that, of course, age dominates these predictions, and there are some comorbidities that play a much more important role, as well as the time between symptoms to lab tests for COVID diagnosis. What is the accuracy of predicting ICU admissions? The performance remains high, and you can see again that our model on the basis of all the features is doing really quite well. But if we want to predict ICU admissions, it's really all the features that matter, and just looking at specific comorbidities is not sufficiently high, it doesn't lead to sufficiently high performance. Again, the performance of our model is better than Cox regression or the Charleston comorbidity index. We can also predict quite accurately ventilation. So which patients are going to be needing a ventilator? And we are making these predictions again solely based on data available at hospital admission time. We have built a demonstrator which can highlight how this technology could be used to inform the decision maker of hospital managers. And what you can see here is a hypothetical hospital. We put here UCL London hospitals, but this is only hypothetical. And what we would like to show is what is the current utilization of ventilators. And also on the bottom of the screen, what you are able to see is how on the basis of the current utilization of resources in this hospital, in this hypothetical hospital, we can forecast for the days ahead how the current patients that are currently admitted will need resources and how these resources are evolving over time. This can inform subsequent admission of patients, such that the hospital manager knows what resources he or she has and how these resources will be utilized over time for the current patients and what the additional admission to the hospital would require in terms of resources. Hence, somebody can decide not to admit somebody at the hospital and instead send this patient to another hospital that may have more resources and may have capacity to deal better with this patient. This is important because changing patients in the middle of their disease and transferring them to another hospital due to lack of resources is not a desirable thing. We can also provide information, again, not to make decisions ourselves, but to inform the clinicians about what is possible in the short run and in the long run with this particular patient. So we have a patient here that's 65-year-old, has a certain amount of comorbidities and previous treatments, is a male patient that has COVID-19, and what you can see is the cumulative chance of discharge and the cumulative charge of mortality and how this evolves over the days of hospitalization. We can also see the additional benefit from ventilation at the current moment in time. Once again, I'd like to emphasize that this is only for demonstration reasons and is only for information reasons and not to make decisions. Also, machine learning can go beyond what I presented here. There are many future opportunities. We can estimate longitudinal trajectories of disease, develop early warning systems. This is especially important for COVID-19 patients, for which it seems that some patients are unexpectedly deteriorating and doing badly. So we need to identify early which patients are those and try to support them before such deterioration occurs. And for that, my lab has developed many technologies over the past 6 to 7 years. And some of these technologies are already validated, so they may play a role here if we start to have longitudinal data. Develop personalized treatment recommendations for each patient, inform policies and improve collaboration among hospitals and clinicians. For that, we are able to use technologies that we have developed on inverse reinforcement learning to identify how the policies at the current hospital or for a particular subgroup at the current hospital could be used to inform and improve the policies at another hospital. We need to manage uncertainty and be able to understand how as the disease progresses, we need to adapt these different models. And automated machine learning methods are especially useful to be able to do that, such that models are adapted as the patients are changing over time, the disease is changing possibly over time, as well as the available resources may be changing over time. There are a variety of other settings where machine learning can be useful, and I have outlined that in my link post a couple of days ago. I would like to ask you to take a look and to get in touch if you are interested in these technologies. Thank you very much.